Hey everyone, my name is Ashton Gleckman, and welcome to Behind the Score, Season 2, Episode 5 for Hans Zimmer's Man of Steel.
Thank you.
So in season one, we spent a whole lot of time looking in on Hans's music as a channel, and we looked at Pirates of the Caribbean, The Dark Knight, Gladiator, etc. And what we noticed was he approached each score with a sort of different mindset and a different aesthetic, but it all had his same sort of touch. And I guess we as composers, we all approach this craft of composing music for visuals in a slightly different way, right? There's things that we do, there's things that most of the time we don't do. Hans is no different, but the thing about Hans is that unlike many others in this field, he really takes chances and he really tries to push things forward by putting himself on the line and by making himself vulnerable and really trying stuff that has not been tried before. And I think he's constantly done that, whether it's The Dark Knight and using just this solo cello, crazy glissando for, you know, a character you'd imagine, this huge Hollywood blockbuster. You're going to have this huge, hard-hitting, orchestral, epic, you know, villain theme, but it's just this cello, right? And that's taking chances.
And I thought my jokes were bad.
Give me one reason why I shouldn't have my boy here pull your head off.
How about a magic trick?
And with this one, we see this incredible combination between soloists and ensemble, almost forming this orchestral rock band, right? We have guitars, we have basses, we have this 15-player percussion ensemble. I mean, it's really pushing stuff in a significantly different direction and really trying to make things new and fresh and push things forward. So that's something that I really admire about his work on Man of Steel and just in general. And that's something that we have observed in looking at his various works. So the way that this video is going to be laid out, we're going to start out by our introduction / score overview, looking at his collaborators and a little bit more info about the score. Then we're going to look at our theme gallery, so the various themes that Hans composed and how they sort of tie into the film. And we're also going to be looking at the suite, of course, and breaking that down after that. And then finally, we're going to be looking at some technical aspects, so samples, mixing, blah, 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 fun stuff like that. So first things first, let's go ahead and dive into our introduction and take a look at some of the different things that we have going on here. So Man of Steel. So Man of Steel was composed by Hans Zimmer, who is known for scores like The Lion King, Crimson Tide, Thin Red Line, Gladiator, Dark Knight, etc. So additional music also and rhythmic design was done by Junkie XL, who is known for the upcoming Tomb Raider film, but he's also very known for his very percussive style in scores like Mad Max Fury Road. Additional music composed by Andrew Kaczynski, who is one of Hans's longtime collaborators, who's written additional music on everything from Dunkirk, of course, to The Dark Knight Rises, etc. Steve Mazzaro is Hans's main assistant, who works with him, I would imagine, on a day-to-day basis. He's writes additional music for most all of Hans's films, and he's probably most known for his work on Chappie, which he co-composed with Hans. I really apologize if I pronounce this incorrectly. Atli Arvursson, he is known for the recent Hitman's Bodyguard, and he's a great composer with his own sort of individual style as well. So the album was produced by Stephen Lipson, and it was co-produced by Hans and Peter Asher, who's a fantastic record sort of producer, and he is very known for his collaborative work with Hans and with Remote Control Productions. So of course, this industry is something that presents a lot of isolation issues, right? Being locked in our rooms all day, looking at screens, and sort of missing out on one of the most essential aspects in humanity, which of course is human interaction. Hans realizes this and purposefully tries to evade it, which is brilliant, and it works so incredibly well, because he likes to work with musicians who each bring their own professional background and they each add their own spice to the dish. And I think that Martin Tillman, you know, Anne Marie, George Daring, who's worked on over 1,000 films, they each bring their own flavor to the score and they each add something incredible. And it's just something that cannot be beaten, you know, with samples. He samples these musicians while he's writing. But when you have a musician who's literally reacting from the notes that you wrote, and it's not just a moment captured in time, it adds something completely different. So let's go ahead and run through the list. So Steel Sculptures, Chaz Smith, Interstellar, and the Saw films, which was composed by Charlie Clouser, and you saw a whole lot of that weird Steel Sculpture stuff going on there. I am not going to try to pronounce this name because I just do not want to butcher it. But for solo vocals, she was also featured on 300 Rise of an Empire. For bass, Lee Sculler, I believe, and he's the guy with the long beard, really, really talented. George Daring, who's probably known as one of the most known figures in scoring in terms of musicians and a great collaborator who's worked on literally over 1,000 scores. He's worked on probably everything that you could imagine. Every score, I mean, just look it up and look at the music department because George Dering is probably there. He's very respected and he's incredibly talented. So, solo cello, Martin Tillman, who is featured on The Dark Knight. He's had a great collaborative relationship not only with Hans, but with Harry Gregson-Williams. So, solo violin, Anne-Marie Calhoun, who was also featured on 12 Years a Slave and The Lone Ranger.
This is the first instrument I've played that I like a little bit more than the other violin that I've been playing my whole life. And that little bit more that I love it has just grown exponentially.
And then finally, in terms of synth programming, we have Hans Zimmer and the fantastic, incredible Howard Scarr, who is well known for his work with Yuhi and especially his work on Zebra. He worked on Blade Runner 2049 recently, Dunkirk, and he's probably most known for The Dark Knight. He's fantastic. So since most of the film takes place in America, Hans wanted to find a way to portray the look and feel, so he created a table steel guitar ensemble.
Let's misuse them. Let's not think of them as country instruments, but because they function very similarly to cellos or violins. Let's just go and turn them into our orchestra, and let's just go and celebrate that sound.
Yeah, you know, now we've been sort of floating around the middle ground, and I want to get to the low stuff.
Yes.
More vibrato.
No vibrato?
More vibrato.
More vibrato.
Yeah.
I don't know if I've got more vibrato.
I'm sort of creating my own little string section. There are strings, there's section. It just so happens there are pedal steel guitars.
So going back to Hans's creativity and looking at that, Hans quite literally commissioned 15 different drummers to come into a scoring stage, play tons and tons of different grooves, which he then incorporated into the score. And, you know, you had players from Pharrell Williams, you know, to Satnam Ramgotra, who, of course, is a great collaborator with Hans, who is the percussionist, the drummer on Hans's tour. And you had 15 different drummers, all who come from different ends of the spectrum in terms of sort of style, and they all have their own background, and they all brought something really, really fun to the score. And it adds this incredible other dimension to the percussion section.
The idea is we all play the groove together, you know, and because you're all individuals, I know little things are going to start sneaking in, which are interesting. And we'll see which grooves work best. If we start each groove in a sort of a, you know, wherever it feels good, and do that for like 16 bars, and then people can start getting a little more individual about it, you know, and by the end it'll become whatever it will become, right? I've used drums before in scores, but if you have one drummer, it sounds a bit cheesy. It's a little bit like if you have one solo violin, it's always sort of right in your face, but if you have a string section, it sounds beautiful.
Alrighty, so recording location. So the score was recorded at the Eastwood scoring stage in terms of the brass and strings and also a little bit of the drums. It's a fantastic room. It's been used a whole lot. And then we also have the Fox Newman scoring stage, and that was, of course, used for a little bit of the drums as well. So you could Alan Meyerson is somebody who usually likes to record elements separately. He has his own style in terms of mixing, and a lot of the times he likes to record different sections separately. So he's going to record the strings differently from the brass, and then he's going to record the brass separate from the woodwinds, and then in the end he'll combine those all together. And I think that's just sort of the way that he works, and it's a very neat way to work, and you have a lot more control over the various sections. And with different composers like James Newton Howard or Danny Elfman, you're pretty much recording everything in the same room. But Hans's style and these types of scores, which are so incredibly big, Alan needs that control, and that's why they record different elements separately. But yeah, these two scoring stages are great, and they've been used on a multitude of scores. Eastwood is probably one of the most popular scoring stages on Earth. So guitar, bass, and cello were recorded at Remote Control Productions, which is Hans's sort of studio in Santa Monica. It was either probably recorded in Hans's room or one of the various recording studios that they have on location. So one thing that Hans and his collaborators and in general people in the film scoring world do now is they'll write things called suites, which is pretty much when you will compose a duration of music without scoring to picture. So this might have been Zach sitting down with Hans and telling him the story of the movie, telling him about Clark, his character arc, telling him about Zod, telling him about where he came from, Krypton, and maybe Clark's parents. And that, you know, was so inspirational to where Hans went into his studio and wrote 30 minutes of score, which then became the nucleus of the whole entire soundtrack. And Hans has been known to write these suites. And recently on the Blade Runner 2049 soundtrack, I think there were 4 or 5 suites written just for that as well. It's a great way to lay out your ideas and be organized and have everything presented in front of you before you even begin the scoring to picture process. So Hans collaborated with Junkie on a multitude of these suites. The General Zod suite, a lot of the material was not present for General Zod in Hans' suite, so I would assume a large weight of that was Junkie. The Clark Kent suite, which of course included the "What are you going to do when you're not saving the world" theme, so Clark's theme. Action Drum suite, you know, very Junkie XL, very Mad Max heavy, incredibly percussive, incredibly intense, and that was carried through the whole entire soundtrack. Then we have Arcade, which of course included a lot of Zod material as well, a few different variations of his ostinato pattern. And then we had the Earth Suite, which included a lot of the table steel guitar content, a lot of the sort of America musical stuff, and that's really the sweet material that went on in Man of Steel. So we'll talk a bit more about this in Chapter 3 when we talk about the 4 main elements of this score in particular, but themes are very important in general to show the importance of a place, of a character, of an item. You know, you have the ring theme from Lord of the Rings, you have the earth theme from Gladiator, and in this score, Hans chooses to focus in mainly on character. So we have the Zod theme, we have Clark's theme, which are it's sort of used to show his humanity in a sense, because even though he was born on Krypton, he has a very human upbringing, and even though he has these special abilities, he has this very human emotion. And so it's the simple little theme, even though it's this huge superhero movie and there's tons of villains and there's, you know, sci-fi, it's a very human movie simply because of Clark's character. And we also have Clark's family theme, which is used a lot during the very emotional scenes in the film. So let's take a look at Zod's theme. Here it is. So there is the theme. It's quite effective to show Zod's character. Obviously, he's someone who is trying to terraform Earth, trying to kill all the humans so that Earth can become Krypton. He's an interesting character because he has semi-good intentions for his people. He's trying to find a place for his people to be after his planet is destroyed, but at the same time he's incredibly evil because he's trying to kill all of humanity, and he has this very big grudge against Clark and against his family. And that minor six is pretty cool. That isn't in the original one. That's from the Arcade suite, by the way. All right, so next we have Clark's theme. So this is a very important theme used throughout the whole entire film. Major fourth. Back to the major fourth. Minor sixth, right? And you're expecting he's gonna, but nope, he does not resolve it, which is fine. I mean, all the music theory teachers would tell you you have to resolve it, or else you're wrong, but can't always listen to the music theory teachers. Gotta rebel. That's the only way to push things forward, ladies and gentlemen. Rebel. Break the rules. So, Clark's family theme. So this is really an important theme because it's used all throughout the film in a variety of ways. A lot of the times in the solo violin during the very emotional scenes, for example, when he's being sent off into the into space towards Earth in the pod, this is the theme. Thank you. So they're the main themes for the film. Of course, there might be more themes, but I wanted to focus in on the themes that Hans spent the most time developing, and therefore the themes that have the most significance or the most importance. So there are the themes. Let's go ahead and move on to the score analysis and breakdown section of the video. So let's take a quick second to talk a bit about the four main elements from Man of Steel. First, we have the rhythmic elements, the sonic elements, the thematic elements, and the orchestrational elements. So with rhythmic elements, we have a whole lot of where Hans uses the orchestra as a rhythmic tool. Hans also likes to combine the orchestra with the percussion section and use it in a very rhythmic way. Then with the sonic, elements, we have synth textures, we have custom steel instrument contraptions by Chaz Smith. And it's interesting because Chaz will take things that are either broken or stuff from everyday items and use them in a very try to create some type of sonic world from that, from that piece. So he'll take an old parachute strap or whatever, and he'll combine that with metal in some type of way to create a really cool sonic texture. And when you use everyday items as tools for music, it's quite literally infinite the amount of options that you have. And so treating not only the orchestra as music, but treating the world as music, that's a very important aspect, not only in this score, but in Hans's scores in general. Then we have the thematic elements. So we have two main styles of themes. We have the melodic themes and the textural themes. And Man of Steel, of course, incorporates both. Clark Kent's piano theme is a melodic theme, while Hans's use of the table steel guitars is a textural theme. They both have the same impact. When you hear one of them, you automatically associate that with this specific thing. The Dark Knight Joker theme is a textural theme. You hear it, you know it's the Joker. So even though the textural theme doesn't have a melodic content, it still functions in the exact same way. So textural themes, melodic themes, very important in this score in specific. Then we have orchestration. So in this score in specific, we have heavy strings and brass, little to no woodwinds, heavy use of solo elements, solo guitar, violin, bass, and cello. And even though they are solo, they are still blended into the ensemble in many different ways in sort of, like I said, a rock band environment. We have the drum kit ensemble, so 15 different drummers. We have the table steel guitar ensemble as well. And so those are just some of the main elements in Man of Steel that make the score sort of what it is. And each of these elements have their own significance and importance during various sections in the film. For example, during the very intimate sections, really what we're relying on is the thematic, content. During the huge battle sequences, we're heavily relying on the rhythmic elements. During the sort of spooky underscore style moments, we're relying heavily on the sonic elements, but each of them have their own importance throughout the score. Alrighty, so here we are at the beginning of the suite. You can see our synths are really carrying most of the weight, just sort of creating that sonic landscape under this main synth melody that we have here, which is this guy. And this is directly prior to when we introduce Clark's theme on the piano. And this is all from What Are You Going to Do When You're Not Saving the World? And you can see we have this little sort of high-end synth. And they're super, super subtle, but they just sort of add a little bit of shimmer. So that's what we have going on there. And then apart from that, during the sort of when we play the Clark's theme, all that we really have going on is we have these sort of deep percussion hits that are just adding a little bit of sonic interest. And in context, that sounds like this. And then, so that continues until we get into this next section, which is the sort of the main Superman theme. And in my eyes, I think that the Superman theme is a bit different from the Clark theme. The Clark theme is sort of subtly emotional, while we have the Superman theme as being huge, bombastic, and sort of epic, and the sort of the cinematic Superman that you'd imagine. And so when we introduce this this thing right here, we come in with these sort of drum toms that's being doubled by a tambourine. And the drum kit toms are a little bit more soft, but then we have some damaged toms that are sort of doubling that, a little bit more aggressive. The tambourines are barely audible, but they add a little bit of shimmer. And then we have these sort of ambient toms. So when you combine that all together, you get a pretty wide... And then our timpani is pretty much doubling our piano down here. And during this next section, we introduce our bass guitar, which is right here. And that's being doubled by another piano, which is a much more bright piano, much more intense. Sounds like this. So for the strings, I think the strings are really important because in this specific piece, I went more for the LA sound, which is a little bit more harsh. Of course, these are Dennis Sands mixes, which remind me much more of Alan Meyerson mixes than Jake Jackson reminds me of Alan Meyerson mixes. They're much more bright and they're much more out front and much more in your face, which I sort of enjoy. And Hans's string sections, a lot of the times, have a lot of brightness to them and a lot of that LA sound. And Desplat said this as well. I mean, Hollywood players just play with more harshness and more aggressiveness, which is perfect for this specific type of score. So you can see here, when we introduce our strings, we come in with this ostinato, which is being played actually by Majestica, which is a library from Adeo. And this is actually the only patch that I like from the library. Everything else I could care less about and I don't use. But it has a really cool... really harsh sound, which I absolutely love. Then we introduce our bass guitars, which actually is just the stock contact sound from the factory library. And then we also have the basses that are doubling the cellos. And the basses naturally just have a more harsh sound than the cellos, so it adds a nice little... nice little doubling thing right there. Our brass at this point is quite sort of big and open. When we introduce our melody, you can see our trombones are supplying that low end. And our horns are taking care of the melody, which we're of course doubling with the piano and the cellos. Right here. And we're just building and building and building. And right here we of course introduced the two other trombone voices. So now we're just sort of building and building. And here's where we begin to get bigger. We introduce our... and then our huge brasses comes in. And you can see, of course, our tubas are supplying that sort of low-end feel. And another thing about the brass is that it's very important to not write your voices too close together most of the time, because you want to try to make your brass sound as big and open as possible, because the timbre is so incredibly intense that when voices are too close, things start to get a little bit muddy if you have too much stuff going on at the same time. So really try to write the brass more open. And with this specific section here, since we have a whole lot of stuff going on within the orchestra, we have live recorded guitars, we have this huge string section happening, and with Hans's music, you have a whole lot of low end. You really need to watch out for about frequency control, because if you have too much stuff going on at one time, it gets really, really hectic and insane. So you can see our brass is quite bright. I took a whole lot of the around 250 hertz around that area, took it down quite a bit in the master mix for this section. And that leaves a lot more room for the percussion and a lot more room for the guitars as well, because the guitars do have a little bit of mid-range as well, especially in this specific section. So that's what we have going on in our brass. Then for our strings, you could see we introduced our violas that are sort of playing a sort of counter, I would say like a, I don't know if this is possible to say, counter ostinato to our main guy right here, which is still playing the same ostinato we had at the beginning. But their violas are introducing a little bit of that major third in there, beginning to fill in our harmony, which is really nice. And then again, we have our basses that are playing, just adding a little bit of that sonic low end to the string section. And then finally, we get into this next section where we have the main sort of that thing. And the thing is, I needed to split this into two separate patches, because if it's a live player, they can automatically do that. But when you're dealing with samples and you're having to generate everything from a computer, you have to compensate that using sampling techniques. So the thing is, we have this thing, which are very sort of... it's definitely not staccatissimo. It's supposed to be staccato. They're a little bit more, supposed to be a little bit more free and expressive. And then we have these guys, which are much more harsh. So they're both the same player, but two separate patches. So we have that, and then our violas are sort of filling in this nice warm harmony. While our cellos at this point are just sort of repeating themselves, adding that sort of really aggressive tone to the lower string section, while our basses now are just really just riding free. So the main thing is we have these really, really cool guitar things that are supposed to replicate what the table steel guitars theoretically would be doing, right here. And we have two separate recordings that are just panned both, you know, one hard left, one hard right, just to add a little bit of dimension. And then we have these guys that are just sort of carrying the... And then we have the guitar that's sort of doing the... doubling the high violins. So our synth section is pretty simple. All we really have is we have our sub bass, which is adding a little bit of low presence to the mix. And then our percussion is really what's going on here. I mean, we have a whole lot of percussion. So there's a lot of strike force, a lot of Hans Zimmer percussion. And you can see, let me just play it. You can see we have a whole lot of these sort of toms that are sort of coming in and doing those dun 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 dun, right? And then we have a lot more of the sort of downbeat style drums that are sort of much more puncturing and supposed to sort of land a little bit more. So if I play that again. Okay, here we have that. That, for example, being the ATO Taiko ensemble. Just it's much more hitting drum, and it has a lot more of a puncturing sound than the toms, for example, which work a whole lot better for the sort of fills that we have going on. And then we also have some snares that are sort of accompanying those tom fills. And when you combine that all together, you get this sound. And it's important for the percussion section to have a multitude of different characteristics. For example, having some drums that are really ambient, some drums that are really up front and up close sounding, really in your face. Having some drums that are really wide, some that are really sort of centered. And when you combine them all together, you get a much more wide dimension or a much more three-dimensional sound, I would say. So then going into this next section, we have the emotional sort of Clark theme that's used a whole lot at the beginning of the movie when Clark's being sent away. And since I didn't have a solo singer for this one, I used Vocalese from Heaviosity just to add a little bit of that human voice element. So here's where we go into our sort of second big section. So we come in with our horn, and then we have our low brass, and then we double our horn with strings, and then we double our violins with a violin an octave above. So we have octave violins along with our French horn just to add a little bit of power and intensity. And so brass in this specific section is really, really important to add the weight that it needs. So you can see we've added in these low brass impacts, which sound like this. Or if I even lowered an octave. It's weird because my studio flooded, so I had to move up here, and my Native Instruments Complete Control S88 is too big to put on the table, so I'm using this Oxygen 61 that I had lying in the basement, and it's weird getting used to it, because you have to use the octave button to move between octaves. But so we have that going on in our low brass just to add that punch that it needs. And that is being doubled by a choir right here. Again, for female choir, it's good to have a certain amount of frequency or dynamic control, or as Alan Meyerson likes to put it, harshness control. Because a lot of the times with the human voices, when you have a big ensemble of people singing together, you get quite a harsh sound. So it's good to sort of control that. So in that specific section, we have a little bit of frequency control and a little bit of studio enhancer just to widen it a little bit. And then again, we have our sub bass, and then our percussion section is again sort of wacky. Here it is. And you can see all the different types of percussion that we're using, right? We have these damaged toms, solo toms. We have this drum kit. So our percussion section for this last part is quite insane. this is, at this point, I'm just sort of putting everything together and trying. So you can see here, we have this really ambient drum. We have a much more beefier, still ambient drum. Then we have much more harsh ambient drum. Combining that together. Then we bring everything together. Alrighty, so for chapter 4, we're going to be taking a look at some of the technical aspects having to do with this mock-up. So first things first, let's take a look at our mix console. So you can see a whole lot of the stuff we're using is frequency control. It's really important with this type of music to keep frequencies in line, or else things start to get really messy and a little bit crazy. So we have tons and tons of frequency control. And for the brass, it's really, voicing is really important for the brass, obviously, but also taking out some of that sort of 250 to 300, really, really important, and then adding a little bit of brightness as well. So for our main master bus, we have a limiter, we have a frequency control, which is just taking out a little bit of the mids, a little bit, adding a little bit of highs, and then I also added an instance of Neutron 2, just to give a little bit of final touches. To the mix, which I'm actually trying out. I actually don't own this yet. I have the demo, and I find it to be amazing, and I'm probably going to buy it after this because I really, really love it, and I love the presets. And then also for reverb, I'm using a whole lot of black hole reverb in terms of the things that need to be really spacey and really roomy. For realistic reverb, I use QL spaces. Alrighty, then for the guitars, here's our clean guitars. So we have a little bit of reverb down here, a little bit of gain booster just to add a little bit to the clean signal. For the more aggressive guitar, let's see if we can find that. Here's what we have going on. Just a sort of nice meaty cabinet with a little bit of extra distortion just to add a little bit of kick. Alrighty, so let's talk quickly about samples. So I'm using a whole lot of sinistrings for the main string section. For the bass, I'm using the Factory Contact Library. For the cellos, I'm using Majestica, the staccato cellos. I add a little bit of room noise just to give it a little bit of a realistic feel. That is from Sinistrings, and there's just a room noise patch, and you can actually set it to be triggered by the host, so whenever you play it, it automatically turns it on. In this case, I set it to the setting where you have to have a MIDI note triggering it, just for better control. I also use action strings for some of the triplet stuff. Just to get a much more realistic feel from that. For the high strings, I use Metropolis Arc 1. I'm also using Metropolis Arc 2 for the low bass staccato stuff. So, this type of stuff. That's what that is. And then I think we have Mural for this guy. Should open that up a little bit. So that is Spitfire Mural. Has a really, really nice sound to it. Alrighty, then for the brass, it's pretty much entirely Metropolis Arc 1 and Cinebrass. The tubas are from Metropolis Arc 2, the ring tubas. I love the way that those sound. All the horns, I believe the main horn is from Cinebrass. And then the really aggressive stuff, for example, the trombone ensemble, all that, that is all from Metropolis Arc 1, because it has a really, really kick butt, intense sound. And then finally, the low brass impacts, or the Brahms, those are from Cinebrass Pro, and that's the Monster Brass low ensemble. It's really, really great. For percussion, I'm using almost entirely Strike Force, but I have a little bit of Hans Zimmer percussion for the Tycho ensemble. And then a little bit of Damage, just to add a little bit of harshness to it. And then also a little bit of Metropolis Arc 2 for the low sub hits, and also for the low percussion hits in the beginning as well, which you can hear right here. So there's that. So for synth, I'm using almost entirely Omnisphere. I would recommend Omnisphere to anyone. It's super, super fantastic. It has literally everything that you could think of. And in terms of synth, I didn't need much more than that. So that's pretty much what I'm using entirely. And then for the sub bass, I'm using Albion 3. There's a really, really great patch in there. Yeah, it's from the Juno. Adds a nice low-end feel to it. Here it is. And then the other one that we have in Omnisphere, just to give it a little bit of flavor, it's called the Cold Virtual Analog Pad. So that's what we have there. Then for pianos, my Clark piano, which is the piano that I use for the main melody. Let's check out what we're doing there. Looks like we're using the Grandeur. And we have the lid set to mid, just so it doesn't have the insane brightness that you get from it being open, but you get a little bit more of the softer tone. If you go all the way, it's a little bit too soft for me, but I like to go just a little bit. Right in the center. And then Drake's piano is great. It's from Metropolis Arc 1. Well, I guess I'm just gonna play it. Has a certain amount of harshness to it that I think works really, really well with the basses. And then for the piano, we have Alicia's Keys, I believe. That's playing the melody. And this is doubling the cellos and the brass. Also, I forgot, for these trombones here, I'm actually using Berlin brass. I really love the way that the solo trombones sound. So we have a solo trombone going on for each of these, just to fill in the harmony, combined with that low-end F. Sounds nice and rich. And then for choir, we barely have anything going on here. We have a simple little choir section right here. Oops. Which is a Lacrimosa. And then we have vocalese, of course, in this section, just adding a little bit of emotion. Where are you? There it is. Nothing too up front. And then we have this choir over here. Oh, come on. Which is from Metropolis Arc 1. And I really just love how insanely aggressive the singers are singing. It's just so crazy. And the choir effects in Metropolis Arc 1 too is also fantastic. Again, just because of how harsh it is. Alrighty, so there is Behind the Score Man of Steel. Thank you so much for watching. I had a ton of fun with this one. I'm going to put the project session down below in the description if you guys are interested in checking that out. If you guys have any questions regarding it or any recommendations for future Behind the Scores or videos, I'd love to hear it and put that on the agenda for the 2018 year. If you guys aren't a part of the Global Composers Network, we are going to be having a get together at 2018 NAMM in a couple weeks, and love to see you there. So if you aren't already a part of the Global Composers Network, do check that out on Facebook. But thank you guys so much, and I look forward to seeing you guys in the next one. See ya.